In this video, we're computing a definite integral of square root 1 plus cosine x. And this is a pretty tricky integral because it requires a trig identity you may not use that often. So the relevant identity that I have memorized is this one. So cosine squared is 1/2 times the quantity 1 plus the cosine of twice the angle. And we use this all the time to knock down even powers of cosine in integrals. But in this case, what we're interested in is the 1 plus cosine 2 theta part. I'm going to solve for that. And then really what I want is 1 plus cosine of x. So I'm going to replace theta with x over 2. And I get 1 plus cosine x is equal to twice cosine squared of x over 2. And the whole point of this is that now we can replace the interior of the square root with something that's easy to take the square root of. And I'll go ahead and pull out the square root of 2. And it's tempting at this point to just say, well, the square root of the square of the cosine is just the cosine. But there's a subtle issue lurking here. The square root of a square of a thing is actually its absolute value, because when you square something, you always get a positive result, and then you take the square root, you'll get a positive result. So this is equal to cosine of x over 2, but only if the cosine of x over 2 is positive. If the cosine of x over 2 is negative, then this expression is equal to the negative of the cosine of x over 2 in order to make it positive. So we have to think about, where is the cosine of x over 2 positive and negative? And the cosine function will be positive here as its argument goes between 0 and pi over 2. That means x goes between 0 and pi. So we're going to break this into two integrals. And the first one goes from 0 to pi. And that's where the cosine of x over 2 is always positive. So the square root of cosine squared is just cosine. And the next piece is from pi to 2 pi. And on that interval, the argument of this cosine is going from pi over 2 to pi. And the cosine is negative the entire time. That means the absolute value gives me the negative of the cosine function. And that's just to make it positive. Then we can guess antiderivatives by using the chain rule backwards. So the antiderivative is basically the sine of x over 2, but there's a factor of 1/2 floating around that we have to deal with. So when I take the first integral, I actually get 2 sine of x over 2. Just checking mentally really quick. When I differentiate that, the chain rule produces a factor of 1/2, and that cancels the 2. So this is the right antiderivative. I'm going to move the minus sign out in front of the second one. And the antiderivative is the same. And now it's just a matter of evaluating these limits of integration. Certainly some things are going to vanish here. I notice in the first one, when I plug in the lower limit, that gives me the sine of 0, which is 0. So no need to write that down separately. In the second term, when I plug in the upper limit, I get the sine of pi, which is 0. And what we're left with for the first one is a 2 root 2 sine of pi over 2, but the sine of pi over 2 is 1. In the second one, we have a negative 2 root 2. And then because the non-vanishing answer comes from the lower limit, there's an extra minus sign in here, minus sine of pi over 2. And the sine of pi over 2, of course, is 1. And these minus signs cancel, and I end up with 2 root 2 plus another 2 root 2. And I've got the answer for my integral. It's 4 root 2. And we're done. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.